Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to the 6th anniversary special of Kevin Pollak's Chat Show. Without further ado, please welcome to the stage the host of Kevin Pollak's Chat Show, international star of stage, television, and screen, Kevin Pollak, and also Jamie Foxx and Sam Levine.
Thank you. Please be seated. I'll wait. Behind me is Sam Levine and Jamie Foxx.
Oh, thank you.
Woo! Oh, yeah. Thank you all so much for getting your tickets in advance. It really takes a lot of pressure off you when you tell the owner, Flanny, who's the greatest guy ever, that you want to do a show. It's really nice for him to be able to tell you at some point before the show that it's sold out. I have experienced both versions. And I will tell you, the text from Flanagan saying it's sold out is way better. What do you want to fucking do? Do you want to add someone to the show?
More like your Gabriel Byrne.
It
is. I'm just going to be honest.
Yeah, it really is. It is. I can only do Gabriel
Byrne. And I only know because I have to live with the guy.
So. You live with Gabriel Byrne?
Yes.
I wish.
All right, you fuck yous. And that's in case you're wondering why they're sitting behind me. So listen.
I'm going to be, and this is going to happen a lot. I'm going to be doing a lot of leaning, one of those birds.
They've rigged it, I think, so we don't have to do the lean. I think I probably should have shared that with you. We've got some of your questions that you were kind enough to fill out. You're going to have to actually stay for the entire show for the Q&A. We've carefully planned it for the very end. In case the show walks people and they ask a question, they'll hear about it later. This is our 6th anniversary. What the fuck? Yeah. Very excited. Two incredible guests today. Both previously have appeared on the show. We've not had many repeats. I think, can we count the repeats? I think Greg Proops, because he had something to sell.
Proops.
Jim Norton.
Mike Binder.
Jim Norton. Mike Binder twice?
Was he on the anniversary special, the first
dear
anniversary
God,
special
no.
as well?
Sam's always right about these things, so I shouldn't say, dear God, no. Anyways, a couple weeks ago, we did a live show on the road, which we've done very few of these.
Oh, with another repeat guest.
With another repeat guest, Matthew Perry.
There you go.
Was kind enough to fly all the way to Scottsdale, Arizona, and complain only a tenth of the way there.
Yeah, why didn't you guys fly to Scottsdale for the show?
That sold out. So we are so happy to be home and ask our guests to simply drive the way it normally works out. Those of you that were dragged here and didn't know much about the chat show part of the evening, because Flanagan, always the wise one, put just stand-up comedy on the calendar. And then if you click it, oh, I see, there's all this other shit. All right, well, I guess I'll sit through that. Jamie and I were discussing backstage. Should we talk about it? I was going to talk about it. You going to talk about it? I was going to talk about
it. Because when it sold out so quickly, I'm like, clearly...
Yeah.
I don't think there's this many fans of the chat show.
Yeah. How many people were dragged here and have never heard of the chat show
being
before?
Being self-deprecating, though, which is what I do.
That's true.
So.
Feel free to applaud if you were dragged here and hadn't heard of the chat show prior to tonight. Those that applauded, please leave.
No refunds.
It's the only way we can find you. But thank you for being dragged along. So we'll do some chat show stuff in the first half of the show. We'll take ourselves a little intermission, and then we'll deliver on promises made on the calendar. Dana Carvey and Will Forte have some very, very funny shit to share with you in the second half of the show. Yeah, I'm pretty excited about it, too. I don't mind telling you. We rarely get that aspect of the show. We have on a couple of occasions, but not many. And tonight's a huge treat, so thank you all very much for being here. This is a live recording of a podcast. We normally stream live most Sundays on the YouTube, and then it's up on the iTunes and the Hulu, and then Earwolf.
Because I refuse to say the earwolf. Sam, reflections on 6 years, go.
I am still waiting to get paid.
Only funny because?
It is true.
We did not rehearse that. Simply because you refused to come to rehearsal, but all right, whatever, it doesn't really, it's not important. Write to us, won't you? Contact at kevinpollockchacho.com. We love to read your emails on occasion. Sam's doing the next live show. We're going to take Easter Sunday off so that Sam and I can go out on the streets and beg forgiveness for killing your Lord. And for the record, we just pointed and let the sheriffs, the Italian guys, do the work. He's over there, seriously. The one in the sandals. You. The me guy. Here's the deal. He could have been king of the Jews. For all intents and purposes, he was the greatest Jew that ever lived. But he was too damn good. He was clean. 233 episodes. I think that's what this is. 233, if I'm not mistaken, in 6 years tells you we do like to take some time off.
I clearly just show up because Sam and I looked at each other like, I just show up every week.
J Mac, 233.
Yeah.
Yeah. There you go.
All right.
Jason McIntyre, one of the research producer, one of the main producers. If you listen, for the 17 of you that do listen to the show tonight, you'll also be happy to know that evil Dr. Kenny Chen is also in tow. New addition, Mike Duman. Samantha Ward, makeup, very little used tonight. Just Sam, you guessed it, just Sam.
She did my lipstick.
She did?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, excellent. Last piece of business. Is my directorial debut, Again Stay Seated, Misery Loves Comedy. Hits theaters April 24th. We sold to Tribeca Films after debuting at Sundance Film Festival. Yay, yay, yay. So Sundance Films does this day and date thing, right? So a couple of theaters in LA and New York, and then your iTunes, your on demand on every cable outlet that you have. And then, the second push at the Tribeca Film Festival, which is kind of great, April 22nd, if you're from New York and live there. Look for us there at screenings on the 24th and 25th as well. All right, Jamie, Sam, anything to add before we begin the shenanigans with the guests?
I just want to reiterate, no refunds.
We legally have to point that out.
Yeah.
Because it's happened. People get up, I think it's usually something like, this is bullshit. I'm paraphrasing. My first guest on this sixth anniversary show is a comedy juggernaut and the star of his fairly brand new television program on the Fox network that you're all DVRing tonight, being here instead. Last Man on Earth, please welcome Will Forte! Those of you at home, he's hugging Sam and Jamie.
Too sweet.
All right. Yeah, slide that over. Go right ahead. Slide that on over. I got you. We normally do the live streaming video. Tonight is audio only, a very special episode.
Great. Well, yeah. I'm delighted and honored to be here.
It's not a Senate hearing, so you don't have to. Senator, that's the first thing I like to do. I don't know if you remember, Will, when you did the show before. I like to ridicule the guests right at the start.
No, I remember.
In any way, shape, or form. Try to embarrass them. So tonight, they started doing these double half hours.
Yes.
Last week or the week before?
We started with a double, then did two singles, and then now we're double pumping.
Yeah, double pumping.
Yeah.
It's pretty damn exciting.
It is. I mean, it's weird because, we wrote it thinking that it would be parsed out one episode per week, and so there are a couple cliffhangers that turn into, like, instead of having a week to wonder what's going to happen, you get like 3 minutes of that. So that's, yeah. It's great though. We love that as writers. Constructing that. No, it's good.
Yeah, you're a little torn because you're the creator of the show, which is an unbelievable rarity. I don't know if you've done the math and people have forced you to consider this over and over and over again, but very few stars of their own show actually solely created it. Certainly Seinfeld with Larry David, but I mean, there's so few to choose from.
I didn't really solely create it. The guys, Chris Miller and Phil Lord, who did the Lego Movie and Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs, 2122 Jump Street, we all got together and thought it out together.
And then the network said, fuck them for the opening titles?
Yeah, no, I don't know how that, you know, I don't know if that was just them.
I did do a
lot of work. I'm not saying that it, you know, I don't know how all that stuff works out, but right. I guess I am technically
editor's
the creator.
Editor's note, Will,
like,
is one of the most humble actors in the world.
But Sam. I'm sensing a little bit of Elvis. I'm sensing a little bit of Elvis Colonel Tom. You'd rather not deal with the negotiation side of things. Because, you know, that created by credit in the biz is a crazy, wonderful, fantastic thing. And it's also wonderful for you to give your co-creators credit on this. So they're running the show while you're...
Well, I mean, I fucking hate the created by credit. We wanted to have no credits, but you can't... Like, they don't let you do that.
No, they don't.
Because we just want... I hate those things popping up at the beginning, and I just want people to get into the show and be immersed in the show, and
yeah,
who gives a shit about a credit?
It's annoying.
Yeah.
Yeah, who gives a shit about the credit? Well,
I tell my mom I created the show,
that's
and that's
right.
enough for me. Yeah.
What I'm are you very doing? Humble. I really am. Sam had something there.
What are you doing, honey, on the phone, she asks, and you answer, I'm creating a television show.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can't beat that. Yeah. I'm going to start telling my mom that, even though it's not true.
Tell her you created...
Nice I'm creating a new show, Mom.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just tell her this is on TV.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
She's in her 90s, if I'm not mistaken.
What, mine?
Yeah.
No, dear Lord, please. Oh. Early 80s that we know of. But so I remember seeing you, I think when you did the chat show originally, you already had a sizable beard in preparation for the show, goes my memory.
Yeah.
How long did you actually have to grow it before you started shooting? How long did it take to get that tumbleweed of a face?
Oh, man. It was probably 6 months.
The answer is yes, 6 months. You were wise to ask that in a question form because I have here 6 months.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
6 months?
6 months and 4 days, technically. So you were very, very close.
Okay, good.
Thank you. Again, J-Mac, great research, as always. I mean, you know, it's a hell of a commitment that you had to have dealt with along the way numerous times. Yeah, in terms of explanation, because it went beyond a fashion beard. It went beyond a comfortable beard.
Yeah.
It went into, well, you know what I'm talking about, right, folks?
But it's...
Did you give it a name? How would you describe it?
It really is, it's I considered it like an adventure. It was, you know, very few people get to experience having that level of a beard.
And, very few.
Yeah.
Also, in the research, the answer is 17 in the history of mankind.
17? Oh,
it's out to here.
It is. It's because we're right now, the era we're in is one where a lot of people have beards, but they're usually, even the crazy beards are kind of manicured on the sides and then get nuts down here.
Sure.
But where I had a problem with society was this part. People don't do this part. And so I'd be walking up and...
it was cat-like.
Nobody was mistaking this for a hipster. This was like, you know... dangerous.
Yes. Let's put it this way. If Foursquare were still a thing, you could have checked into your beard. There was a joke there when I started. So, Did you have worst case scenarios where you kind of had to help people understand why, that you weren't homeless?
Well, that's the thing is you basically do look homeless.
Well,
unless
it just looks
you are
unmanicured.
You have to wear a tuxedo or at the very least a black suit. Anything else, actually the beard's kind of coming back, so I'm just realizing how hideous I must look right now. So I'm sorry.
By the way, you don't look hideous on the show with that giant uncontrollable beard. It's for comedic purposes.
But the thing is, we were working very hard on the show, so we would go in, we'd be writing all the time, so I wouldn't see anybody. I wouldn't have to explain to people. The people that I would see are my closest friends, my family, and they all knew already why I was doing it. So, right. I started as a writer before I got the SNL job, but I never knew how much work it was. It's just the most tremendous amount of work. And
writing
I'm
your show.
Still doing it. Yeah, just the writing process, and then I didn't know what I was signing up for. And I'm delighted to have gotten to do it, and I'm very proud of the show, but just it really has
editing.
Been...
You're doing
the
everything. I mean,
gnarliest year of my life.
Right. Today, in fact, you were working on some music for the show for post production.
I don't write the music. I just like listen to it.
He's credited for it, though. Just for your mom.
Yep.
It's certainly not for you. It becomes careful what you wish, right? Because you have this crazy idea, and you and your pals create this show. And you get to execute it. It appears as though you've been able to execute it without any restraints from the network. The silliness that happens on the show is so not the normal network crap, thank God.
Well, they've been very... Oh, thank you. I mean, they've been very supportive. And, there are always going to be conversations about different things. And, we certainly... it's weird. You look back and there are things you wish you had done differently always, but we made the decisions we thought were right at the time and I stick by everything we've done, but like it's just a I forget your question. What's that doing?
As you said, you started as a writer, you're not used to talking to people.
Yeah.
Necessarily.
That was earlier though.
Yeah, no.
That was the last
Yeah.
What'd you ask?
I'll be honest with you. I have no idea what I asked.
I'm not even joking. I can't remember anything. Yeah.
6 years.
It's all in a...
6 years of this.
6 years. Okay.
It's all on a need-to-care basis, Will.
I'm trying to remember what it was, because I had a great point.
Let's just keep talking about
the
beard.
Get to.
Well, no. Just in terms of care for what you wish and having to see...
Oh, that was it.
Yeah,
yeah.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah, careful what you wish for.
And then
that was my point.
I don't want to...
No, but it really, you work very hard. It's
the network
it's
has
exciting to be
way.
Able to be proud of something that you did, but it also, that's a year that I didn't see my family, didn't see my friends, really. It's, is it worth it?
That's something you'll have to
it's
decide.
It's great. It's like if we ever were lucky enough to get a second season, I just got to figure out a way to
factor in your family.
I fucking miss my family.
Yeah. Yeah.
God, I feel like I'm going to cry. Seriously.
Well, but also just in terms of the network staying out of the way. I don't want, spoiler alerts are tough when a show has been on, what are we, 6 weeks into this now or something like that?
Something like that.
But talking to various sized balls is one of the most original things.
Which we stole from Castaway.
Yes, yes, and you're clearly, again, without the spoiler, it's a tip of the hat. It's one thing to be inspired by, which is what you're doing on the show. It's another to steal. The setup and the payoff is ridiculous, but by the time you're talking to, 11 different balls in the bar, it's the most silliest and abstract moment I remember in TV and just laughing uncontrollably at the accomplishment of getting to be that silly and abstract.
Oh, man.
And
thank
playing
you.
It small Jeez. And hilarious and the genuine, that's one thing, also a difficult line your show walks, which is be silly and abstract, but play it real. Every square inch of it seems to be played real.
You are not fully caught up yet on the episodes, clearly.
Yeah. I'm caught up until tonight. I'm not okay. Seen tonight, as no one of us here yet has. But no, look, character gets to be a little arch, but everyone's, what I like about it is that there's this foundation of reality at all times, you know?
That's what our intention was. And, you know, sometimes we might veer off into nutball territory. It's hard not to because it's just fun to and
fireworks.
You know, hopefully we don't go too far over the edge, but it's you know, that was our intention the
right.
whole time was to try to, it's such an absurd premise already to try to keep it as grounded as possible. But then you still got, you know, trying to find twists and turns. There, you know, there's automatically going to be kind of a level of coincidence that you need to
yes.
fall into, but you know, you live with it and
yeah.
and hope that people are okay with it.
Were you able to have fun so far in the first season? Because that's the hard part
oh.
when you're in the middle of the eye of the hurricane.
I mean, yes, I had a lot of fun, but it's a lot of work.
Yeah.
I mean, it's you know, I'm not trying to look for a pat on the back, but it's been 8 months, 7 days a week, 15 hours a day, you know.
Well,
at the least.
I'm glad you mentioned that because we have a little.
And before it was like a year where it was like six. You know, I don't know. It's fucking crazy. I'm almost done. I'm almost done. But it's like, after a while, you just. I'm losing it. I'm losing it.
Will, let me just add a wrinkle.
I'm so close. I'm so close to being it.
Let me just add a wrinkle. Can you imagine if you'd done all that work and nobody was watching it? Because that's most fucking shows.
Yeah, but then I wouldn't. I'd go in and I wouldn't, like, I'm in the editing room. It's like, yeah, that's fine. Yeah, do that. You know, but, like, now it's like, oh, don't, you know, try not to fuck it up. But it's God, it's just, it's so much work. It's just
all of that hard work is paying off because this crowd is the tiniest indicator of how everyone else.
Oh, thanks,
feels.
God. You're. Thank you. Oh my God. You're catching me at the very end of this very long,
it's
arduous
process.
It's just
about killed
so it's,
you.
It's yeah.
But
I
it
mean,
has
it's,
just
know,
about killed you.
And it's still like you know the you know I went for a family. Well, never mind. It's just a lot of work.
It sounds like if the show, God forbid, said the atheist, doesn't get picked up, there's a part of you that's going to celebrate, and when it does get picked up, there's a part of you that's going to go, oh.
Fuck yes. Oh my God. No, I would be delighted if it got picked
sure,
up.
Sure,
I mean I love it. I love everybody that I get to work with. It's just
except
the
for
most
that one guy.
Incredible. Well, there is one guy. But it's been a great experience and I wanna keep doing it. It's you know, the challenge is to figure out a way to just
have a lot.
Work less. And that's the thing, like you learn so many lessons. It would be a total shorthand.
Yeah.
You'd hopefully get the same level of quality without the amount of work and knowing what you're, it's just, you know, everything was totally new because
yeah.
that was the thing I was saying earlier. I used to be a writer, but like on the low level side, so
right.
I didn't ever have to know how to put together a show.
And even
like
during
that.
SNL, you would write stuff and perform stuff, but it was small little increments of a bigger show that you didn't have to worry about.
Yeah. I hope the show gets picked up. I hope nobody thinks that I'm.
Yeah.
I'm
well, we all hope it gets picked up.
No, I don't want anybody to.
During
pick up.
This show.
I love it. It's just a lot of work. Poor
we,
me.
We always ask people to write in questions on Twitter or any other social media that you might use. This one comes in from at Lawns for you, Will. Do you see Last Man on Earth as a show that could run long-term 10 seasons like Walking Dead? So we've talked about just one more season, please. What if it turns into 10 years? Again, I have the correct answer here. Yeah,
there will probably be some pretty crazy shit happening in the end of season two, and then it'll just be the... No, there's no one... No, I mean, you know, there are so many talented people working behind the scenes on this show that, like, we would find a way to get it done if we were lucky enough to do that. Our plan was always just to, we kind of knew what we wanted to do in the first season.
Right.
And as we've been going along, we have ideas for, you know, if we were to ever get a second season. But I don't know. You know, it's that's not a question I can answer. You know, we'd be incredibly honored to get to do any more than one season of this show. You know, it's hard to look that far into the future.
Nearly impossible.
Yeah.
But we appreciate you trying. Will, we're going to have you come back in the second half of the show, do a little performance piece, and also another Q&A with the audience's questions.
Can we talk about, like, one happy thing now? I feel like I've been a sad sack, tired.
Yes, I'll give you one opportunity to talk about something happy, but I don't have any questions for it.
Oh, I got stuff.
Sam?
Can we talk about Benjamin Franklin?
That,
is anything happy?
It does make me happy. That was a,
it made me very happy.
What?
It made me very happy.
Well, thank you very much.
Later in the show, you're going to do a piece that you actually used as your SNL, one of the things you used in the SNL audition. Is that?
Yes, yeah. That does make me very happy. There was this, should I just talk about it? There's a,
just set it up later.
You know, you at SNL, you do a, basically you come out, your audition is do three characters and three impersonations, and I ended with this song that I used to do at the Groundlings.
And then don't save the rest for later for sure.
Okay, I'll set it up.
But that makes you happy, singing this song, and it's all of its ridiculousness.
Yes, I unfortunately won't get to do the whole sketch, but the song is pretty powerful. So, but I'll set it up and thank you guys. Now I feel like I've been a real downer. God, I'm trying to think of some.
It's the first half of the show. We have to create a little conflict leading into this.
This is great. Yeah, that's great. That's
Will
great.
Forte, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you very much.
Please welcome Dana Carvey.
How long can I work this look? It's fucking too late for the mop top. The reason I have this I've had this haircut for 35 years is because Senator, I never touched the girl. Why do we have 1948 microphones?
Because
they don't have them.
You don't have to lean in. It's super powerful.
Objection, Your Honor. The body was never found.
Well, am I killing the sound man?
Pretty much. Oh. Yeah. This is the audience loves you, and the folks at home are going to try to understand. Yeah.
Do this because I want to be hip with the whole thing.
You got to Instagram it.
Well, no, I'm. Well, hold on. God damn it! There you go.
There you are.
All right, there we go.
It'd be great
now,
with the lights.
I'm going to explain what this is about in terms of our social dynamic in America 2015. Now, I took a picture of that, and so I'm going to tweet it, Instagram, and Facebook it, and say that I destroyed here, and that's the reality. I'm still going to do the show, but it's done. It's done. That's it. That's the new reality. That's what matters.
You no longer have to be great. You just have to let people know.
Oh, no, being good doesn't matter anymore.
No.
Oh, no. Should we, what do you want to do? Woo. I've known you since the 19 flirt flirt.
Yeah.
We're like Burt Reynolds. Remember Burt Reynolds on Carson? Be like, I've been here since 91st. But yeah. Now we're turning into those guys. And that was years ago.
No, we did meet in the San Francisco stand-up comedy scene.
Yes.
Of the late 70s. It's on the internet. We can openly talk about it.
It was late. We were drunk.
Just the one time.
Chip Romer.
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
It's not important who is catching and hitting. The important thing is...
We are in dangerous territory right now.
We were young men.
We were young.
You were unbelievably handsome.
Really tight. I had a very tight body.
I'm not saying it was a great body. It was just generally there was a tightness.
Well, it was younger.
Tight, a tight little body would be the way that I would describe myself.
You,
and you in your leather pants. Remember? Not a joke. He wore leather pants. You and Shanley were the only comics who had leather pants.
And I gave Stephen Baldwin shit about wearing leather pants. Yeah, he, first time I met him, he was wearing leather pants, and he hadn't arrived on a motorcycle or a horse. But I do remember at one point I had white leather pants.
Yeah, and then you had white leather chaps. Which I thought was really ballsy.
Yeah.
Auditioning at the Comedy Store in white leather chaps. Well, and there was no Western motif about your act.
You want to stand out any way you can.
Okay. Set it up.
So you've been enjoying the social media a little bit. I noticed on Instagram you've had, Jamie's been following one sort of melodrama in particular.
I decided, yeah. Well, the idea was you get social media and it's like, wow, you could be free and creative, you know.
Sure.
But I have an assistant who's from Ireland and he's very adept at this. So he said, I should follow anyone on Twitter who follows me.
No.
So he goes, you could be the people's champion. Direct quote. He's from Dublin. So he spent in the evenings, he'll follow like 1,000 people while he's reading or eating. So I'm following, I think, about 65,000 people. He never wants to catch up with my Twitter followers, but I'm following 65, you're the people's champion. And he barks like that. But so I decided with Instagram to do something more creative. So I took some fruit and I drew little characters on it and I created this sort of melodramatic murder story with sci-fi elements. And Jamie's a big fan and I'm gonna do the final episode tomorrow.
Really?
There's gonna be a sci-fi element.
How many episodes do we suppose there's been up till now?
Maybe 20. I'll put it out as a children's book or something. I don't know. But yeah, it was really fun. It was completely going against the grain of I'll be on Instagram and you'll see my whole life and we'll be friends. And then it's like a Ponzi scheme. And then they'll follow you and you'll follow them and I'll follow that because, I mean, isn't it sort of like give me more?
Yeah, it's one of the reasons I put off Instagram for as long as I could just because I'm not enamored with anyone's photos.
Right.
I know what your dog looks like. You had that to eat.
Well, it is. It's so much life force going into this, notwithstanding emails, the whole thing. Your whole life is in this. And, you know, I thought of the thing, I don't know if it would work, but to maybe truncate it into an app I call Insta Twit Face.
Sure.
And
please explain.
It gives you, what you do is you collect twit faces. So say you're in a restaurant, you see someone, you're able with the app connect to them, go twit a face, not a twit face. If they say twit face, you collect that twit face and you put it in what I call a queue of 100 twit faces.
Just 100?
Just 100 in each queue. The idea is to get to 100 queues. But if I'm at a restaurant somewhere and I go, are you a twit face? They say no, I lose my queue. And then I have no twits on my twit face. Anyway, it's a meta joke about the wasted nonsense of that. I wouldn't do it in my stand-up.
Right.
I got the wording wrong. My son.
I promise you, it'll
Insta
be an
twit
app.
Face will be an app.
This will
tomorrow.
Be an app within 24 hours, and the company will sell for $1 billion. Yeah.
So should I do my John Lennon thing? I was on the fence whether to do it in my stand-up or casually with
him. Well, here's the thing: we were out at dinner.
Yes, because it was hatched with
Paul and Jamie
and I won't try
to remember how it came up, but at one point
we just said.
Yeah. How does Paul McCartney explain to John Lennon what Kanye West is?
Yeah. Yeah, that's pretty much it. And then we started jamming on it, and it became kind of part of my stand-up, where, you know, John's from heaven talking to Paul, you know, and, what does Kanye do? You know. Is he a singer?
Well, you know, he's got an auto tune.
No.
What's an auto tuner? Well, it's a kind of device that makes you, you know, so the wobbly bits don't get all wobbly about, you know.
Does he write? Is he a writer?
Well, they take samples of other songs and they sort of rhyme on top of them. And that's called a sample.
I call it more like stealing.
Not necessarily. It just sounded funny. All right, here we go. This will be popular, this next one.
Well, does he have a partner? You know, because Yoko used to help me with all the things and bits and bobs and stuff. You know, who's his partner?
Well, he's married to a very nice gal with the name of Kim Kardashian.
But what does she do?
She takes pictures of a bum.
Pictures of a bum?
Yeah, and she puts them on Insta-Twit face.
Did I? It could go on.
Oh, it can go on.
It can go on.
You can call it back during the stand-up if you want, and because there's a three-act play here. I mean, it's...
Well, what happened was... Now, you know, and many people have claimed the throne. Conan is a friend of mine, huge fan of the Beatles. So we're just... Because I was 9 years old when they were on Ed Sullivan. So right. I was like, I was sold. And then meeting Paul McCartney, that story which I told on your... In 86... By the way, when I first got SNL, I was not on it. Well, let me back it up for any young, aspiring show business folk. I had never done sketch comedy, and I was just doing stand-up. And I'd auditioned for Saturday Night Live several times in clubs, total bomb. I followed Kennison at the Comedy Store at midnight, devastation. So I play just dead silence. Isn't that, well, special? You know, yeah, ah! You know, it's like nothing. He levitated the room, literally, which I did. My son did ask me a while back, who is the greatest stand-up? And I said, well, in a given moment in time, I don't think anyone was better or more charismatic than Sam Kennison. So I showed him some Kennison online. He went, wow, holy shit. Yeah, that's the real deal. So anyway, so I'm playing a pizza parlor in Martinez, California. And played to four people. Half the crowd hated me. Good night. And then I auditioned for Saturday Night Live because Rosie O'Donnell allowed me to be on at the little club. I don't know if is this a story that people know.
Sure.
And
Igby's.
Lorne Michaels came with the head of the network, Brandon Tartikoff, and Cher, and to watch me. So I got the show, and then Lorne Michaels said, maybe we'll come out to Long Island, you know. And I go, okay, I do whatever he says. So I lived in Lorne Michaels' house for the month of August. And I'd never been, you know, I was terrified. I kept thinking I was going to get dismissed or be told to go away. And then Paul came over. Lorne just said, Paul's coming over tonight. And I was, you know, I said, Paul? And he goes, Paul McCartney.
Hey, it could have been Paul Simon.
Could have been Paul. He had a lot of Pauls. So then, Paul came over all those nights, you know, Dane, and I was so in awe. And
the first time you opened the door, was there something?
Oh, yeah. Well, he did say, and it's not a joke, they ding-dong, Dana, would you like to get the door? It's probably Paul. And it was a big old mansion, and, you know, and I opened the door, and it was Paul and Linda. And I just, you know, it was so bizarre for me that Paul did say to me, your face, it's going a bit funny. True story. But I was awestruck, but I had, this is the...
By the way, he's faced, at that point, 75,224 people who looked at him with absolute shock and horror, and he had to give you shit about it?
Well, a little witty line.
Yeah.
But, you know, I had the presence of mind in the moment not to always ask someone something obscure. You know, I didn't want to go, who wrote Eleanor Rigby? You know, I, being a fan of Paul, and I had all his albums and all John Lennon albums. We were fans of Lennon too. We had T-shirts made. What's it got to do with John Lennon? All my friends in the 70s.
Nice.
Kind of like, why are you talking to me? You know. So we were huge fans, and so I brought up a song on an album called Tug of War that McCartney had made in 1980, and the title song Tug of War, and the lyric in the chorus was one day we'll stand up on top of the mountain with the flag unfurled, but it won't be soon enough for me. So I brought that up to Paul. And he's just listening. You know, I did the whole thing, tug of war.
And he goes, well, I thought of it, you know, like a big flag unfurled, you know. And so
I was his best friend after that. A. Whitney Brown, Chevy was there. He always migrated toward me. And then they put on a CD of a song he'd recorded, but wasn't on any album. So it's just Lorne Michaels, Chevy Chase, Whitney Brown, me, Linda, and Paul. So Paul's where you are. And the song starts, he leans into me, his new best friend. I met him 5 minutes ago. And he said, quote, I'll never forget it. He goes, you know, sometimes when you're writing, you end up trying so hard to live up to whatever, you end up ruining the fucker. So the cool part was then we're smoking weed. I didn't smoke weed at the time, but, you know, if a beetle hands you a joint, you know, so.
I think that's in the Bible, actually, if a beetle hands you a joint.
And I wanted to make him laugh so hard, and somehow it came up of a story of a horse shooting a commercial, and then the horse was shitting on cue as part of the commercial or the comedy piece. So I don't remember what the joke was. But I would just have the old trainer would come out and drop his trousers to get the horse to shit and go, come on, it's like this, you know. Not funny, but Paul thought it was hilarious. So I know, I got him really, really laughing. And then the next night when Paul and Linda came over,
yeah,
he brought his new album, Press to Play, and I go, oh, you brought the new album. And Linda said, see, I told you he'd be glad we'd bring it, right? So they had a conversation about me. So they were talking, they were driving home. It didn't bother me.
Do you think you like it?
Do you think you like it? He probably drove like that in an old kind of British car.
You know, it's getting shifty, getting shifty. I don't know, it's very dark in the Hamptons.
Meanwhile, meanwhile, they have a driver and they're both in the back seat.
Yeah, so we had that relationship. So here, it's a trifecta. The last two parts are quick. 10 years later, in the mail, a big frame thing arrives from Paul for me.
That's what the audience is thinking. I wish he would hurry up.
Well, I always feel like anything I've ever said, they've heard, you know? Don't you guys go to sleep every night to a chat show? I mean, the headphones could be minty.
Sure.
So he sends me a framed album, autographed, and a little message to me. We sent this to a few of our grooviest friends. I hope you enjoy it. Paul, you know. So I thought, well, okay, that's just that. So then I'm at the 40th, okay? So we're doing the 40th anniversary of Saturday Night Live. So that's a whole other thing we can talk about
right,
more.
Right, we will.
But I was going to do a little 10-second chopped broccoli, which I didn't really want to do because there was no setup. It was coming in the middle of the joke. There was no, but I did it. And so we're in a commercial break, and I'm in the front, and Tom Hanks is there, and Jimmy Fallon, and I don't know, yeah. Candace Bergen, name a celebrity. It was like a wax museum. I mean, it's like, it was insane. Like, celebrity, 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 celebrity. It was like, and Eddie Murphy right in the front, you know, just looking. So Paul's over there, so Paul, because he's so famous and people want to genuflect and kind of, he just does the goofy thing, I think, just to keep it light, you know. Oh, ba-doo, ba-doo. So, let me see, do we have the piano?
Please.
I don't know anything of piano, but I know this one piano riff from For No One on the Revolver album.
Yes.
Do you remember For No One? So Paul's right over there, and we're waiting for the show, whoops, sorry. All right. Waiting for the show to start, and, you know, go back from the commercial, and everyone's kind of nervous. So the piano, and Paul's looking at me, and I just go like this. I go. And he looks over and goes, oh, I know what you're doing, Danny. So.
That part was just for the live audience. We cannot afford that musical clip in the podcast.
I'm going to insta-twit face that remark. So then I didn't know whether maybe from the 86 thing and talking about a tug of war and then the album and then we had this moment, I thought, nah, it's just my imagination. He's not my new best friend. And so then in the good nights, there's 100 comedians on the stage. There's Billy Crystal's next to me and Mike Myers over there and Steve Martin. And we're just doing the good nights. 40th anniversary is over, 4 hours long. And then someone's massaging me. Really nicely. It feels really good. It's Paul.
Dan. I know. Oh, you tighty-whitey, Dan. You know, we're digging in the deltoides. Very skilled. So.
You know, I have the exact same story, but with Huey Lewis.
If only.
I don't want to brag.
If only we had started with that, Sam, and
I
built
like
to
Huey
the
Lewis.
Paul McCartney.
Yeah.
I don't know how much more than that we can ask, quite frankly. We've got the Q&A coming up later that you're going to participate in, and maybe we'll have a question from there as well. But for this
like
part of the show, we're going to now bring Will Forte back onto the stage.
Yes.
If he's backstage somewhere, there's Will. You guys can share that.
Share.
It's really powerful.
Pleasure.
Did you guys actually meet at the 40th anniversary? You met prior to that?
Yeah.
And who was... I'm glad neither of you remember any details.
He brought an obscure lyric from one of my... No, I don't. And I'm a soldier. No, we met there. I've always wanted to meet Will. Love his stuff. Hysterical.
And for
it's crazy to hear.
Yeah.
That's nuts.
Yeah. And for you, growing up or coming up, as it were, in the comedy scene and watching the 1986 on version of SNL, there must have been a few sketch players that caught your eye. Ultimately, list one.
I'll tell you that it was something I've mentioned, you know, coming back from the 40th, everyone's asking how it was. It was the most exciting night of all time.
It was really crazy.
A special night. And I've gotten a chance to meet a bunch of former cast members when I was at the show, but I had never gotten to meet him. And, you know, one of the all-time greats at that place.
I wanted to meet you.
So, I mean, it was... I was watching Wayne's World from the side, and I was just realizing just kind of how much stuff I had stolen from you. And just like,
you mean like
oh
riffs?
My God.
Like timing?
The only difference is like I have thick mustaches usually that I have, but like all these facial moves, I'm like, oh, that's, I just have stolen all these.
I once told Tommy's mothers that I thought that I was influenced by him heavily, and he says he got it from George Goebbels.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I've been stealing from
We're
George
going back
Goebbels.
Now.
Okay.
Yeah, no, it's unstoppable, actually, the influences, and not realizing until even Woody Allen gives credit to Bob Hope with stealing this riff. Yes, well, you know, I came up thinking that was Woody Allen's until I heard him say he had completely just lifted that riff from Bob Hope
it's wonderful.
In the film.
I love that. You're great.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. Should we do it back and forth?
Well,
sure. You know, the one time I did do Woody
Without
Allen.
Without sounding a bit didactic, I think it's extremely important that you look.
The one time I did a Woody Allen sketch when the Sun Yi thing was happening.
Yes.
And it was the only time I'd come out for a cold opening. And Rob Schneider was playing Sun Yi. I came out through the door and no Rob Schneider. Where it's the cold opening. So I had to, you know, this is great. Like, you know, even Sun Yi, I can't find her, you know, that thing. And I was waiting. And then, how you doing, Woody? And he comes in. I didn't write it.
So what year was that you could be racist still on television?
I was voted the most racist comedian in America from my doing a character called Ching Change, a Chinese gentleman who had a pet chicken.
Yes. Were you voted?
Well, you don't get a writing credit in SNL, no bitterness there, but when that was voted the most racist sketch of the year and I was the most racist, Dana Carvey's Ching Change, the sole proprietor, it was, I didn't understand racial insensitivity. I lived in San Francisco. There's a huge Asian population, and I saw a man in his yard had a pet chicken, had a like a dog leash around a chicken's neck. And I fancied this Chinese immigrant who came and had these pet chickens, but he loved them so much he would talk people out of trying to buy them. So Lovitz would come in, how much for that chicken? I go, oh, you don't want that chicken.
And the catchphrase was, that chicken, he make a lousy house pig. He think he like dog, but he not dog. You throw frisbee, he just poke hole in it. 1 minute you got frisbee, next minute you got spaghetti strainer. And it played to silence 30 years ago in 8/8.
That's what's funny.
And then he would sing a My Fair Lady type song. I've grown accustomed to his beat. Do you remember it?
I do remember
it. Yeah, anyway, sorry.
And I remember you telling me at the time, because we would talk on occasion on the phone while you were doing the show, and you, I remember you telling me that it played to silence, and you were kind of not happy, it freaked out a little. And you see, it's just ridiculously funny.
But
maybe we've gone so far with the political correctness that now there's just this a little release valve. Oh, thank God. I'm allowed to laugh at someone.
Well, it was naivete on my part. I was just, I knew. In fact, one night I was writing Ching Change and I was in my little room.
I'm sorry, again, his name?
Ching Change. Change.
So his first name is Ching?
Change.
And his last name is Change?
Yeah. My brother named Small Change because he a little guy. Sorry, I'm going way back. My sister named Loose Change because these are the jokes. Because she let anybody kiss her. It's killing now. But I swear to God, I was working on it, and a lot of times you just say it out loud to yourself in your room. Chica Megalase, I'm facing away from the door. And it was on the 17th floor, like 2 in the morning. I'm a chicken, I'm doing it. And I turned, I'd ordered Chinese food and I forgot. A dead lookalike of the character was framing the door, the bowl cut and everything. Sorry.
Thankfully, you had ordered pork. All right. Oh, boy, this is magical. So let's play a little game. We like to play some fun games on occasion on the show, and we thought we would specialize for you. And Jamie, our head writer, and Sam got together and created this game. So, Sam, you want to explain the rules and how it's going
to
be played?
Absolutely. You don't get two SNL greats without coming up with a little fun for this. So, this is a game that we have decided is called Whose Line Was That? And so here is how the game works. We, Jamie and I have called 10 fantastic lines of dialogue that one of you said from over your years on the show. So I'm going to read a line with as little inflection as possible. And then if you feel that you know which one of you uttered it, you ring in by saying your own name. And then I'll point to you, and then you can either say whether you said it or the other person said it. And for a bonus point, you can tell us which character you said it as.
If you remember.
If you remember.
The good news is, if neither of you remember, chances are someone in the audience will, and they'll get a point. And we're playing for $10,000. No pressure.
Are you guys ready?
Good luck.
Oh, good luck.
I think.
Kevin's going to help me keep score.
I am. Second place pays $5.
Line one. I strapped a baby to a leg press once, and he thanked me when he was 2.
Will.
You think that was
Dana,
Will?
Dana said Will.
He said Will.
I think it was Dana.
It was, in fact, Dana. Oh, that's it.
Will wins. Oh, wait, you came back.
It must have been Hans and Franz.
That is correct.
What's the line again?
I strapped a baby to a leg press once, and he thanked me when he was 2.
I strapped a baby to a leg press. The character morphed. I thought it was...
With no inflection, it makes it harder.
Yeah.
Number 2.
Yeah, that's true.
I recently broke my chin-up record with 8, and I just got pre-approved for a MasterCard.
That's Will.
I think it's Dana again.
There wouldn't be some trick where every single one is so scared.
Okay, that's Dana, Will. You did ring in first, and unfortunately... Oh, wait, no, you did ring in first, and it is, in fact, Will.
Yes!
So that's a point for Dana.
It is a point for Dana.
Can
not
you name the character?
Not a joke,
by any chance?
But I officially really want to win. Isn't that weird?
Well, we're all just a tad competitive.
Why are we
do you have any clue which character?
I just got pre-approved for a MasterCard.
Do you have any idea who, what the character
I don't.
Was? I bet some of the audience does. What's the character?
Ooh, no. Greg Stink. Greg Stink.
From the ESPN.
From the ESPN, yeah.
The ESPN announcer.
It's way tougher without the inflection.
Yes.
All right, here's my favorite. Number three. Pubes.
Yeah, wait. Give him a chance to say the line. Because Danny goes, yeah, if you remember it. What is it?
Oh, I can't look at that.
I recently broke my chin up record with eight and I got free proof of massacre.
That was me.
Yeah.
That was
the game
me.
Is
okay,
way easier.
Okay.
Way easier that way.
Now you know it was you.
It,
sure. Well, you've each got a point.
Off like lunatics somehow? Are we just crazy?
Hopefully. You've each got one point.
Yep.
All right.
Yep. Here we go. Number three. Pubes. I need a lot of them and I need them now.
Will!
God,
it's Pubes, it's Forte.
For sure.
Pubes, I need a lot of them and I need them now. That's MacGruber.
That is correct on both counts.
You know what?
2 points.
I really was going to blow it by thinking it was Garth because I famously said, I got pubes this year.
Now we know he did steal from Garth.
There you go.
Pubes is, well, pubes is a word that anyone can use. That's, it's funny.
Yeah.
Pubes is funny. He went to the bank. He wrote a check and he looked at his pubes. Well.
That was three. That was three.
So you get 2 points for knowing it was you and naming the character. So it's now 3-1.
Ooh.
Again, prize of $10,000. Question number four.
Question number four. They say you're a drag on the ticket. They must have been watching a different show. When you were quiet there for an hour, that was world class.
That was Ross Perot.
That is correct.
And it's tied!
Can I do a 20-second
story? You have to.
20-second story. I'm not a Hollywood person. I usually stay in, watch TV. But I was at the Palm.
There's 0-60 for you, everybody.
Larry King is in the Palm. So I'm meeting this guy. So Larry King comes, sits in the booth next to me. This happened 2 days ago.
What?
Yeah, 2 days ago. So Larry King dials up his wife and goes, I'm going to get Sean on the phone and put you on as Ross Perot. I'm having a meeting with this guy, so I have to take the phone. Larry's here. He's had two cocktail martinis. He's completely blitzed out of his mind. He can't drive anywhere, and I'm doing it to his wife, and she's buying it for at least the first 30 seconds. And then Larry was dying, so I had to put that in right there.
Okay, good.
That was 2 days ago. I'm not going back to 86. And I'm keeping this haircut.
And we have a tied score. Question number five.
Okay, here we go. I'm going to tell my dentist that you said that. He's really self-conscious, and that's going to make him feel really good.
Will.
Yes,
that's,
Mr. Forte?
That's me.
As?
It's a tough one.
Freddie Mercury?
I'll give you a hint. Technically.
Tell my dentist you said that.
I'm going to give you a hint. The character does not have a name, and if you can tell me who you said it to, I'll be very impressed.
I'm going to tell my dentist you said that.
Yep.
Can I hear it one more time?
I'm going to tell my dentist you said that. He's really self-conscious, and that's going to make him feel really good.
Oh, now there's...
Yeah, I'm helping you out there. As best I can.
It's the date sketch with Megan Fox.
That is correct.
Wow. We're only going to award 1 point.
That is correct.
Wow. Award 1 point. Help was given, and we brought it home, but it's still 4-3.
Nope.
We're up by one.
Dentist you said that. Very self-conscious.
I just realized this is all the property of NBC. We're going to have to cut it all out of the podcast. Fuck! All right, Sammy, bring it home. We got
we got a few left. Here we go. Are those really your lips, or are they lip implants like Barbara Hershey had in the movie Beaches?
Will, that's Dana. I know that's Dana because Beaches was on before my... That's a technicality.
Why would they reference Beaches in 2004?
You can. So the point has gone to Will. That is correct. That was your line, Dana. Are those really your lips, or are they lip implants like Barbara Hershey had in the movie Beaches?
Does anybody know the character?
Garth. Was that Garth?
Garth 2?
Oh, Garth.
Steven Tyler.
Oh. Wow. or the implants like Barbara Hershey got and whatever.
You should get the point back just for. Never mind.
God, I can't remember, I forgot that. I want this job.
No competitiveness. 5-3.
Number 7.
7 out of?
Out of 10.
Oh, Lord.
Oh, this, come on, they're getting good. He must smell my dog.
That's it?
That's it.
Oh.
What is it?
That's mine.
That is correct.
Do you remember which
massive head wound hair.
That is correct.
Tied up! 5-5! It's a barn burner.
So exciting. Number 8.
That was it.
Every guy's crazy for a poorly dressed woman.
Will. That's John Bovey.
That is correct. That is correct.
Oh, boy.
John Bovey.
There's competitiveness in the air. It's 7-5. They're focused. They're
zeroed
in.
Final two, guys. Final two. Here we go.
Anyone's game.
I think the presidential seal should be a real live seal.
Will. And Tim Calhoun.
That is correct.
I think the presidential seal should be a real live seal.
And I will not budge on that?
Oh. And I will not budge on that.
All right, fortunately, the final question.
Yep.
Final question.
Final question.
5 points, so it's still anyone's game.
We have tiebreakers ready if needed. Here we go. Number 10. Okay, now before you oil up, it's very important to shave all your body hair.
I'm assuming that sounds like a Hans and Franz line.
That is correct.
Yes. Oh!
I just didn't think I would say that. Yeah. Who did I say it to?
You said it to a bunch of children.
And that's how you play. Whose line was that?
Was it a tie?
Thank you, Sammy.
Oh, wow.
Dana won because I changed the rules for the final question.
Oh, I see.
Oh.
We're going to take a 10-minute intermission and come back with live stand-up comedy. Don't go away!
Let's be honest, folks. If we could all avoid shaving forever, we would. The outrageous cost alone is reason to never shave again. Between the razor burn and the tiny nicks that are surprisingly painful, we all dread shaving. Well, my shavers, it's time to switch to Harry's. Harry's razors are half the price of the big brands, and they ship for free to your front door. Free. Did I mention free? It's way better quality. This dude, Harry, found these amazing blades made in Germany. He liked them so much, he bought the factory. Stop paying $32 for an 8-pack of blades. Harry's are half the price, and you get a shave that respects your skin, your face, your legs, and definitely your wallet. Enough with the store attendants having to unlock those plexiglass cabinets, allowing you to overpay for crap blades. That's been my experience, by the way. Oh, excuse me, can you open this so I can get annoyed and more aggravated with the whole process of overpaying for these ridiculously awful blades? And now, with Harry's coming to my home, I don't know, man. It's just hassle-free, and it certainly works. And they're just better blades, honestly. The starter set is an amazing deal at $15. You get a razor, moisturizing shaving cream, and 3 razor blades. If you use our promo code, Kevin, you get $5 off your first purchase. Men, women, we all need razors that don't suck. Go to harrys.com now. Get $5 with code Kevin on your first purchase. That's harrys.com. Enter coupon code Kevin at checkout to get $5 off. Do it now. Today's episode is also brought to you by Slack. Stop trying to track conversations over Dropbox, email, Skype, Instant Messenger, etc. With Slack, never miss an important conversation again just because you checked the wrong app. Slack, my friends, is a messaging platform for teams at work. It brings all your work communiques into one central place, makes everything instantly searchable and available on any device. But Besides consolidating your team's communication to one place, Slack is also easily searchable, so you can find any convo or file with one convenient search box. It also integrates with most of the tools your company probably already uses. You'll be able to sync Slack with GitHub, Dropbox, MailChimp, Twitter, and many, many more. And you can even post animated GIFs as well. More than 60,000 teams use Slack, including Airbnb, the New York Times, eBay, Yelp, and even Ice Cube Neutrino Observatory down in the South Pole. There's no way I said that correctly. We, by the way, even use Slack. The team that helps bring you this podcast and many others on the great Earwolf Comedy Network swear by Slack. No matter what your business is, Slack will work for you. Visit slack.com/Kevin. That's Slack, slack.com/Kevin to create a new team, and you'll get $100 in credit that you can use when you decide to upgrade to a paid plan. Before upgrading, you can use Slack's light plan with unlimited users as long as you like for free. So give it a spin with your team. Once you're impressed, you'll receive $100 in credit for upgrading by just visiting slack.com/Kevin.
I can tell you guys love riddles. Okay, but don't shout out the answer until I tell you to, all right? Here we go. So father and son are driving on the highway. They get into a terrible car accident, very sad. They get airlifted to the nearest hospital. They're in really, really rough shape. They rush the kid into surgery. The doctor walks into the room, looks down at him, and says, "I cannot operate on this boy. He is my son." Now, how's that possible? What is it? It's his mother? You're wrong. You're fucking wrong. You know why? It was his other gay surgeon father, you fucking homophobes. Come on, Los Angeles. It's the 21st century. Get real. Women can't be doctors. All right. I promised Kevin I would do a tight 45 seconds, so that's it for me. Now, please welcome back to the stage Kevin Pollock.
Sam Levine, ladies and Jews, bring those paws together. So my problem with Christopher Walken is, once I start doing him, I can't stop. I'm not gonna do too many voices, although I'll give you the one word impression I just gave Dana backstage. If you listen to the show, I think I did it once or twice before. This is a one word impression. You can only do one word. It can't be a word that the person's famous for using. That's what makes this difficult. You ready? Liam Neeson in one word. Bananas. Do you want anything on your waffle, Mr. Neeson? Bananas. So the problem with Christopher Walken is, once I start doing him, I can't really stop. The voices, they just sort of, at some point, I'll walk around the house, in this case, as Christopher Walken, speaking only as Christopher Walken for hours. Not realizing that I'm doing it at all. No idea at all until the cat passes out from fear. I'll start my day the way anyone else does. Open up the refrigerator in the morning. Oh, my. We're out of soy milk. I wasn't planning a trip to the market today. But clearly, a drive to Trader Joe's is in my future. Oh, I hope he's there. One time, just once, so that I might say, "Hey, Joe, you're here. I can't believe I come to your store all the time. I just never thought I'd see you here. I love this place. I love how you move shit around. It's fantastic. Look, honey, there's the cheese. I'm just giving you shit, Joe. I do love your store. I just assumed, you know, you'd be out. Trading. But I do. I come here all the time, a couple of times a week at least. I love your place, seriously. But since I have you, I never thought I would. I have a few complaints, if I may. Again, as a regular customer. What's with the green bananas? Why? Why? Must my groceries ripen on my counter? I got a crazy suggestion for you, Joe. It's a possible solution. It's a gift. What do you say you grow your shit before you sell it? Kidding, again, I do love your store. Your selection of nuts, for example. It's crazy. I had no idea such a variety of nuts were available in the entire world. You got them all on four shelves, Joe. It's a shit ton of nuts. What, do you got monkeys coming by? You better hope they don't see those green bananas. They'll tear this place apart, Joe. Those simian cocksucks work fast. You'd be shut down by noon. And then the cat passes out from fear. It's a Tuesday in my house. It's an honor. But first, we'll mention something during the sit-down portion about his Saturday Night Live audition. So now he's going to elaborate. Will Forte!
Hello. I just wanted to mention, because both Kevin and Dana had talked about Christopher Walken, there was actually a sketch at SNL. I'm horrible at impersonations. There was a sketch at SNL when Christopher Walken was hosting, when everybody was supposed to do Christopher Walken impersonations. And I was given a role where I was supposed to do a very bad Christopher Walken impersonation, and I was removed from the sketch because my Christopher Walken impersonation was so bad that it couldn't even get to the level of being a person who was bad at Christopher Walken impersonations.
I just don't know how to do it.
That's honestly the best I can do. I'm not. Okay, I am going to sing a song tonight that we talked about earlier. The SNL audition process, as I said, is three characters, three impersonations. I did Tim Calhoun. I did this crazy prison guard person. I did I did Joni Mitchell singing. Wait, what was it? It was singing to the tune. This is not the song, but what was it? Singing a cover. She said, "Oh, I'm gonna sing a cover of this." See, I'm horrible. I'm gonna sing a cover of "Mamas Don't Let Your Babies Grow Up to Be Cowboys," and it was, "Mamas don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys. Do not let them play guitars and drive in old trucks." How did I get this fucking job? And then, what did I do? I did Martin Sheen. I only did two impersonations because I'm so bad. I did four characters. And Martin Sheen, I just said, "Hello, I'm Martin Sheen. I have a cold right now, so if I don't sound like Martin Sheen, it's because of the cold. If I do, I've honestly did that." How did I fucking get this job? And then I did a speed reader, which I did on the show at some point. And then my final thing that I did was this sketch that I used to do at the Groundlings. It's called The Gold Man. And basically, I have to set it up for you a little bit. So you know those people who are dressed all in gold, who are Third Street Promenade or any public place, and they just stand up there, and they have a jar, and somebody comes up and puts like a dollar in the jar, then they... And so I was a guy who was dressed all in gold, and I, for the audition, I was not dressed in gold. You don't need to know that. But so the sketch went like this. You know, I'm standing up there, somebody comes up, puts a dollar in the my jar, it says dollars make me move, and I do a little movement, and somebody says, oh, that's impressive movement, that's great. And then somebody else comes over, puts a dollar in, I do another short robotic move, and they say, oh, that's awesome. Then everybody sees a sword swallower, and they go to check him out. While I am up there waiting, a robber comes by and takes all my money out of the jar and then just hauls ass, but I can't move because they haven't put money in. They took the money out. So I'm just standing up there waiting to go. Finally, they come back from the sword swallower, put a buck in, and I... I'm also not a very good robot mover. So I get back up on the little block that I'm on, and I look very sad, but I'm still in this. This father and son come up, and they say, the kid says, Dad, why does the gold man look so sad? And the father says, well, maybe if you put a dollar in his jar, he'll tell you. And maybe if you put $2 in, he'll tell you in song. So all these people gather around me, and this is the song that I sing for my SNL audition. Just because I'm a man made of gold doesn't mean I'm made out of money. But the calling I've found is to give people pleasure through incredibly precise robotic movement. That's why I come out to the streets to help me make ends meet. And I work real hard to fill up that jar. Then a bad apple ruins the barrel. Heart of gold, 24 karat. But through all the pain, I grin and I bear it. Heart of gold, but I'm living a golden dream. Cause any way you slice it, we're all on the same team. Come on now, everybody! Heart of gold, 24 karat. Through all the pain, I grin and I bear it. Heart of gold, but it don't make me no saint. Cause I got a little secret, I suck cock for my face paint. Come on, stay with me, people. Heart of gold, I suck cock for my face paint. I suck cock for my face paint. Cock, face paint. I suck cock for my face paint. I suck that cock for my face paint, cock. Face paint, cock and face paint. Cock, 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 face paint. Cock, 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 face paint, cock, cock, face paint, cock, cock, face paint. Cock, cock, face paint, cock, cock. Together at last in a heavenly union. Ka 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 face paint. Ka ka face paint, face
face, face, cock, cock, face, 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 cock, 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 face, face, cock, face, face, cock, 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 face, face, cock, cock, face, face, cock, cock, cock. And the music dies down. I collect my stuff. And I walk out. Lorne Michaels is like in this dark area right out there. It's kind of like here. It's the lights are very bright, so you can't see. But Lorne is right there. Tina Fey, bunch of other producers and stuff. And Lorne stops me as I walk out and just says, "Thank you very much for coming." I have to say, I'm not good at impersonation. "Thank you very much for coming." And I said to him, "Sorry for all the cocks," and left. And I got the job. The next thing I heard was I got the job. I guess it was the perfect amount of cocks. So that is a little slice of my SNL story, and it has been a pleasure to share it with you. And I think we're doing a Q&A, so thank you very much.
Bring back the stage, Dana Carvey. Will, don't go anywhere. We're going to take three seats here. See no evil, speak no evil, and Cox. Gentlemen. Well, we've got just the one microphone. Yeah, please. Oh, God. Sure.
Then we can't share the two mics.
No, he's got one. Yeah.
All right. Wireless, I see.
If I don't read your question, it's because it sucked. This is to, the three of us. Ever had a show or movie pitch that you thought was hilarious but met with resounding rejection? And that's for me, wherever Eve is. Woo, there she is. All right. Be great if everyone, when I said their name, went, woo.
Had many.
So we would know. So you said when you did the bit there for SNL, that number you just shared with us,
yes,
with all the cocks, it doesn't sound like it killed like it did here in the room when you did it. Did it? Could you even hear?
I was singing very loud.
Right.
And there are not a lot of people in the room. So
seven, maybe.
I did not hear a peep.
So imagine doing that song to silence.
Maybe they were laughing during the loud parts? I don't know.
Well, that's just it. You have to commit to it. That was the thing you said backstage. He's
it's fantastic. Yeah. I love his style.
The level of commitment.
Yeah.
That would be the answer. You just have to commit. Mr. Carvey. You're a grumpy old man character. Yeah. How would he feel about millennials and smartphones, or either? And there's no name who this is from.
Let's see. This was something that I wrote with Bob Odenkirk and Rob Smile. You know.
Oh, okay.
So the idea of the grumpy old man, the twist of it, it's very Bob Odenkirk, if you could imagine. Yeah, brilliant writer. Is that the old person would be complaining about his life, but actually then would say he loved it. You know, just for people who haven't heard, in my day, we didn't have flame retardant sleepwear. If you went to bed smoking, you woke up engulfed in flames. Whoopity-doo, look at me. I'm a human fireball, and I love it. You know, that was the turn of it. And I don't know, today, I mean, it kind of writes itself because, you know, dyslexia, he would just be all, you know, if you read right to left, you're stupid. You know what I'm saying? So we didn't have bipolar, we had nutballs. We put you in the loony bin. I don't know. What else would he
get? So very forgiving.
He'd be very politically incorrect, sorry.
Yeah.
Should I go now?
Mr. Forte. Has Ted Turner himself ever seen and or commented on your amazing impression of him?
I've
only seen you do it on Conan. We just you would come out on a giant steer.
I do a very realistic Ted Turner impersonation. I'm actually doing it tomorrow. I'm going on the Conan show. I'm very excited. But I got to do it a number of times, and at a certain point, I heard, "Oh, Ted, I think Ted Turner is going to be a part of this, this next Ted Turner, because we were doing a show in Atlanta, and they brought me out to do Ted Turner there. And apparently, where he lives was almost touching the building that we were doing the show in. And then we heard that he is not a fan. He's not.
Like, he didn't like you mocking him being senile and old and wealthy.
No, maybe the person who gave that information was as wrong as the first person who thought they could get him. I don't know. It's a gray area.
Then did he show up?
I showed up. He did not.
Right.
But I mean, as it's super realistic, so you got pretty much the same.
Super realistic.
Yeah.
All right. Wow, somebody apparently knew I was going to do bananas. And they asked, Kevin, can you do a one-word impression of Barbara Streisand? No. No name to this one, by the way. This is the best one not to put your name on. Can I get my picture with all three of you for my Christmas card this year? No. Again, no. I think no. Dana, your first SNL show was re-aired last night. Well, this will be a couple of nights ago now, but yeah, it was just on, from 1986, where Sigourney Weaver was the host.
Sigourney Weaver, my very first.
What were you thinking about? Tall girl, you had to go up on her.
There were so many people at the 40th Saturday Night Live thing that I was literally talking to Sigourney Weaver, and again, I'm a shut-in. I don't go anywhere. This is a fake persona I put on. I'll be crying myself to sleep in 20 minutes. But Sigourney Weaver and Glenn Close, I was talking to them for a long time, and then Edward Norton and DiCaprio were trying to get my attention. So anyway, surreal. Yeah, Edward Norton, I got to talk to DiCaprio. I can't, you know. What was the question?
Does not matter. What were you thinking about before you began that show?
Oh, well, we were talking about this backstage briefly, because I realized that I'd only done stand-up, but I never had done sketch comedy when I got on Saturday Night Live, and the first host was Sigourney Weaver, and the church lady was put in read-through, didn't really do that well. That week, I'll just tell you the real story real fast. Neil Young had come into town. This is all completely, remember, I was playing a pizza parlor 8 weeks before. Neil Young's in town, Lorne Michaels. Neil's playing Madison Square Garden, and he needs someone to be like a mother or mom who comes into the GarageBand motif and scolds him. So after read-through, I got into some kind of drag gear. I'd never done drag, and I went down and did sort of a church lady character at Madison Square Garden. I found out later that Lorne really didn't want to put it in the first show, but Phil Hartman, God rest his soul, my buddy, he said, let's try it, Lorne. And so then we had the church lady, and it was at the Good Nights, the graveyard, 5 minutes before. And I'd never done sketch comedy, so every time I got a laugh, the church lady, I wanted to look to the audience like a stand-up. But when I said, it's not special, it got a huge laugh. And then it moved to the front, and Sigourney Weaver and I were talking about that at the 40th. Siggy, Sih, Weave, the Weaver, the Er.
The Weave.
The Siffer.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. She's a
This is a very, very provocative question that Adam B. has written for, I guess, any one of us, really. But very thoughtful. I ate pizza last night and feel gassy today. What should I do?
Apologize to your wife.
Thoughtful answer.
Go to a psychiatrist and tell him that this was the question you submitted.
And yeah, you had an opportunity to ask you guys anything in the world, and you thought
that was clearly a joke answer. I'm trying to help this guy. I don't know. I mean,
please
Gas
do.
X, Beano.
What are you? What's your go-to in that situation?
I fart. I just fart.
I'm not a big farty, poopy.
Sam,
guy.
Did you have? Sam actually is a medical expert.
Yeah. No, I have the answer. It's convert to Judaism, and then it's totally acceptable to have gas all the time.
There it is.
Have you ever been particularly a farty, poopy joke guy? I don't know. I never really got
me?
Into. Yeah, I've never
poopy,
seen
poop,
you do
poop,
it.
Poop.
Poopy farty. I never really got into poopy farty jokes.
It's funny. It's never,
I don't know why.
Yeah.
Not never, against them. Just never.
Never a part of it, but it still makes me laugh if it's done out of context in the correct way. I think Jamie and I were walking by something, and there was graffiti. People were just, they were just using pens at the Staples. And they were writing something, anything, just to see if the pen worked. They had a little pad there, you know?
Yeah.
And someone just scrawled out poop.
Right. I like a fully loaded diaper makes me laugh. Fully loaded.
The theory of it?
Or
just
the word
by.
Package or waking up face down in a pile of your own goo. I like that rhythm. I like that word package. Makes me laugh.
Yeah. So,
I would say that I do enough of it to kind of carry the load for all three of us.
But your stuff's brilliant, so that's enough of that.
Will.
Ladies and Siggy was my first.
This is a question just for Will, by the way. Will, have you performed here before? By the way, this is not the question on the card, but I'm just curious. Have you performed in this theater
before? I have.
You have, yeah. Okay. Then you may be the one, in fact, to answer this. From, looks like maybe Sandy, although let's work on the A, I think. Sandy? Could be Sandy. I don't know. It's a horrible A. Is it Sandy?
Might be Sandry.
All right, then I'll be the asshole. Okay. Let's work on the D then. The D, I think, is pretty horrible. Right?
There's, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Your D is fucking worthless. Seriously. I'll eat shit for the A. I was an asshole on that one. But that D, it's like you weren't sure. Is it a D, Sandy? The D?
I had 10 seconds to get
in
the
D. Oh, okay. You're right. Again, I'm the asshole.
Sunday.
But great question for Will specifically. Will, why are the seats at the Coronet so fucking uncomfortable?
You know, it helps to keep people awake, and I don't know. I mean,
you got to talk to
Flanagan. That's going to hurt his feelings. Flanagan is the owner of this
place.
The
proprietor. I think he takes pride in it.
Stick up for him, and I get the fuck out of here, please. No, stay. I want you to see this. Stay.
Between the penmanship and your horrible questions, I think everyone here would like you to burn in hell. This one not written to any of us, could be all three. How much time do you spend doing your hair for a show like this? Thanks, Tony. So a little gratitude at the end. Presumptuous, that thinking we would answer it, but still.
I have not finished doing my hair. There's still lots of movement and fluff and beads of sweat and follicle interaction. Sorry, I got nothing. Okay.
Well,
I don't know how to answer that because it's he yes.
Okay.
Still upset.
I have
a little tension in the room. Interesting. They'll turn.
Now you listen to me, Largo audience. We've got skills we've acquired over 35 years of doing this. If you laugh, no harm will come to you.
You're going to have to read this one.
Will, any chance you want to join the MacGruber's Movember team next year? The
squad?
Oh, the squad raised $47,000 in your name for men's health in 2014. Oh, my God, I would love to. That's awesome. Are you serious? Whoever wrote this, come find me after this. I'd be happy to. If we somehow get a second season for the show, I probably couldn't shave down to a mustache if I have a beard, but I'd love to help in whatever way I can. That's really cool. Honored to be a part of that.
Dana, did you ever find Bugs Bunny attractive when he put on a dress and pretended to be a girl bunny?
Yes.
Just a sincere, yes.
Did you ever find Bugs? You know, the difference between the first movie, they put us on the top of the car, and we had like 20 minutes. You know, she's a babe. You know, if she was a president, she'd be Abraham Lincoln. we threw it all away. And then the second movie, the budget quadrupled. So we had like 4 days and 19 different angles and just didn't. Yeah, that one was spontaneous. In fact, I think Mike was truly laughing. I think he wasn't on acting. I think he really lost it. We had it on camera. They had two cameras on us. Yeah. Completely surreal.
Sure.
Any aspiring actors or comedians in the audience, or anyone wants to do this? Okay.
Wow, that was perfectly played on your part. I don't think we could have asked for a better reaction.
No.
The entire crowd as one said, nah.
Well, I think we inspire collectively the notion of, I could do that. I could do that.
That's the other question. How many never gave it any thought until you saw us do it? And now, I could probably. I just thought that I'd throw this one out there to see if Dana was working on it yet. Ted Cruz, ?
I haven't, but I definitely will, especially if it looks like he's going to get the nomination. Want to keep your powder dry. You could have a brilliant Ted Cruz, and then he fades away and it's nothing. But there is definitely something there. Yeah, that's an easy one to do, I think. Yeah. But I don't have anything. Do you want me to try just without having anything? No, you don't understand how embarrassing and painful it is to try an impression without being able to do it. And
yeah.
So the way to fake it is just to say the name of the person you're doing, and you get at least a quarter of the way there. I'm Ted Cruz. So that's it.
It's all he's got. It's all he needs.
It's all I've got.
Yeah, I saw him with Seth Meyers, and it got a little uncomfortable because Seth was looking for an opening to try to hold up the mirror, and boy, Ted Cruz was just a slippery son of a bitch, and there was no way to, you know, you're watching it just knowing this guy's going to hang himself, and he didn't, and it was sad.
So he's not going to get your vote.
I think.
Do you do Michael Caine?
I think all Jews will vote for Ted Cruz.
Because that's the one I put my mind to early in the year, because I bloody wanted to do it. And I just wanted to find a way to get very down like this and get very sad. You're never going to make it through the wormhole, Matthew McConaughey. All right. Going out of space. So. See, like, if I do this with you guys here, then you can join in. But if I do it in the stand-up, I never have an ending. And then it just goes. Sorry, go ahead.
I love that McConaughey is just a lot of, it's all bells and whistles now.
Pull up your socks, yeah. Play some Broadway show tunes. We're going to outer space. We should put in with the guy, looky, what we got all down hell.
Did you, other than the Ted Turner, were there actually some other impressions that you were asked to do? Because I remember when you called me with the Ross Perot, we were on the phone, and you said, they've asked me to do Ross Perot this Saturday. It was like a Tuesday. Mm-hmm. And I said, what do you got? And you said, I don't know. They gave me some tapes, and you just watched him on Larry King. When you're asked or forced to do an impression, did you have any of those on the show?
I did. George Bush. I did not want to do George Bush.
You took
Bush.
Over for Will Ferrell.
There were a couple people between Will Ferrell and okay. My version, but I say this all the time. Will Ferrell owned that character in such a way that I always compare it. I'd say like it would be like somebody else doing the church lady, in that. And I, you
yeah,
know,
when he would chase like the yarn ball that wasn't there or whatever.
So it was a very hard thing to do to try to do, you know, George Bush after him, because I didn't want anybody to do him after him.
Right.
Because I just suck at impersonations, and I was not particularly good at that one either. So, but you gotta do it.
You do. That you get assigned
to it.
You do it. Well, in my case, being on the phone with Dana and him having to do it that weekend, I got a little screwed, because by the end of the phone call, we both had a Ross Perot impression.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I said, I'm fucked, because Saturday you're going to become famous for doing Ross Perot.
And if I try to do it, they're going to say you're doing Dana Carvey doing Ross Perot.
No, Saturday Night Live is the bully pulpit when you're on there. Yeah. It really is not fair. You get to be the first one out there, and that's it. But he wasn't particularly hard, don't you think? I mean,
well, there were keys and there were little things, and you would like to exaggerate it to no longer speaking a language, right?
Can I finish one time?
But seriously, Lauren had said, there's a Texas billionaire, there's a tape down there, and would you see if he's running for president, see if there's something you can do with it, you know. And I turned it on, he had the ears and the whole thing. Let me tell you, Larry, can I finish, you know, and it was like, I think I can do this one, you know. I mean, Bush Sr. took a year, and I had to make it a cartoon because there was nothing there. We thought after Reagan we were screwed because it was just a guy talking like that and had to kind of take it down and rhythm it and flip it and kind of go out and get, you know. I mean, half the time I thought I was in trouble. Do you ever feel you're in trouble? I was in the cold opening doing this, got it, and I see Al Franken and Lauren. They don't look happy up here, down there. Because the only time in the show you can improvise when you're locked in a shot doing the cold opening, so you can take things, you know. But it was all right. It was all right, Dana, please. Do you know Will Forte? He's in eighth grade. We're keeping an eye on him.
I loved his analogies that were meaningless. He always had an analogy for everything.
Do you know the one? Yeah.
The economy is like peanut butter, see? If you feed it to a horse and he chews on it, it'll look like he's talking.
I love that. The one,
right? Meaningless. No.
The one I could never top, and I remember trying to think of another one that could, for my rhythm of the same thing. It was like, let me put it to you this way. You can't put a porcupine in the barn, light it on fire, and expect to make licorice. Could never top it.
That's the rub, because he's always right.
Well, look, he had good ideas, let's face it. We can combine, you know what we do with health care? You want to fix health care? You combine it with the Department of Motor Vehicles. Hell, they already got an eye test. You're halfway there. He had some good ideas.
He did.
Then he went.
Will Forte, did you actually put the celery in your ass during MacGruber?
Yes.
No, I didn't. It is in the taint area. We did workshop it, but it never went in there. The worst thing was Yorma Taccone, the guy who directed it, a good friend of mine. We took like iPhone videos of it just to see what it would look like, to make sure it looked like it was in my butt. And then for the next several weeks, all these people would say, oh, I saw the footage of the celery in your butt. And that's just not a friendship move. So, oh, wait. That just made me think of one more tiny story from MacGruber. It's a filthy movie. But there's a part where I'm, oh, thank you. I'm in a cemetery, and I'm having sex with my wife's ghost. For all of you who have not seen MacGruber, you got to see it. So I'm, you know, basically I have like a coin purse around my balls and penis, but I'm completely naked. Other than that, it's like 3 a.m, it's freezing, we're waiting to do this take, and then I turned around, and I saw Lauren with his phone up, taking a picture of me standing completely naked, waiting to do this thing, and I thought, Lauren, what are you doing? And a couple weeks later, I had to do a talk show in support of MacGruber, and I asked his assistant, I want to tell the story of Lauren, because it's such a great story. I wanted to tell this story on a talk show. Could you send over the picture that Lauren took? And she sent over like 20 pictures. Apparently he was up there just like, just trying to get the perfect picture. Did not. Is there an erase button for this?
There is. Editing. Post-production. The live audience is the last people to see that story, Will.
For the three of us, what is your ideal pizza slice, toppings, if any, and from what pizzeria?
That's from these the Forte pizza guy again, right?
Yeah.
What is it? Your favorite pizza slice?
Yeah, toppings.
Boy, you know.
Someone just walked out.
Yeah, somebody walked out.
That had enough.
I don't really. Pizza's like a big treat for me at this point in my existence. My cholesterol wants to be 500, but I have it down to 100. You know, with pills, so I can't. I'm not a real. But it would just be margarita or cheese pizza for me. Yeah.
I would. This will probably register with you guys, being in Northern California. But I would say a slice of Blondie's pizza, from Berkeley.
Berkeley,
nice.
Yeah. We're all Northern California, East Bay, South Bay, Mid Peninsula.
Take that, L.A.
Isn't that weird? We didn't grow up in Hollywood.
Oh, this is a question. This is a great question, actually, for the.
Just doing the attitude.
Yeah. For the Bay Area boys on stage, this is a great question, actually. This question is to the Dodger fans in the audience. Does it bother you more how your team shit the bed in the playoffs, or that your rival Giants won a third World Series in 5 years? Mm-hmm. I made that up. And it had the exact reaction I was hoping for. We have time for three more questions. I wanted to see, in after going through the cards, if we could get three last questions live from the actual audience. So just yelling out, the first person to raise their hand is who I'm going to call. There she is. Go ahead.
This is Dana.
And by she, I mean you, sir.
Hello.
Hello.
Sorry, is the perfect placement of your Bieber hat. Go ahead.
This is like a bathing suit from the 1920s or something. It's cool, man. You're young and, you know, wear it. I used to wear those all the time. With Siggy.
I just wanted to see if we could ridicule someone who had the courage to stand and ask a question and try to help us.
That was cool.
The first thing we do, of course, is to attack.
I know. The waves look good today, Bernard. Let's do a little windsurfing. Sorry. Of course, this is what it is.
Yes, sir. Yeah. How would that conversation go about Bieber? So you leaned into your outfit.
As asked by Justin Bieber, apparently. Yeah. I don't have my glasses. Is it you, really? Yeah. Justin Bieber was on Church Chat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. She got all hot and bothered about Justin Bieber, and we had to have a special meeting with Justin Bieber's mom because she wanted to pull him from the church lady sketch.
He was how old at that point?
Seven. No, he was probably 16.
Right.
He was very sweet, but the mom was upset, and I had to go, it's just, you know, my wife's Irish Catholic, I have nothing against, you know, so did that.
You know, who else is popular these days? Well, you know, there's a guy named Justin Bieber. And what does he do? Well, he sort of, you know, he travels around. And he sort of goes to parties and places, you know, makes a bit of a ruckus. And then they take a picture and they show it to everybody. And then he sort of apologizes. Well, you're fucking with me, Paul. He's the biggest star in the world. He just goes around and then there's people say he shouldn't have done it, whatever he did. He's got 300 million quid. Why are you using quid? Why don't you use pounds? I just like the sound of quid. The weirdest... Oh, I shouldn't do that one. No, that's
not. I love that. Lennon's offended by the minutia. It makes me really happy.
Did you have any illicit things you would do late at night that you would never do for anyone else? At SNL, when you're exhausted, Will? middle of the night, just crazy shit.
To try to make the other writers or performers
laugh?
Yeah,
because Kevin Nealon and I had one, but I wanted to.
You mean like a weird thing you would do?
Well, we would do the Beatles reminiscing about sick orgies that they would have. Because we imagined that they were so popular, and the catchphrase was, I remember one time. So if Kevin or I, we shared an office, and we would get psychotically goofy in the middle of the night trying to write some silly sketch, and whenever I turn and Kevin go, I remember one time, and I go, I remember one time. And because it's middle of the night, it's incredibly blue, but do you want me to do a little bit of it for you? I remember one time. I remember one time, you know. I can't do it. I'll get arrested. It's like
Did you just realize that your son is in the audience? Is that what's
No, Dex has heard everything. My son is here tonight. He's a great stand-up. He's wherever he is.
I think he's in the back.
And his friend Ricky. It was just, I'll sing in the more benign one. It was just the case of like, you know, Ringo, you know, George was, you know, Ringo. It's so politically awful in 2015. George had a hard dicky, you know. And Ringo said, what are you planning on doing with that, you know? You can imagine. I'm not going to go anymore because I will leave the theater like this.
Again, the context. It's 4:30 in the morning. You're trying to get through this last sketch.
For
the table read the next day, and you're not.
But anyway, the Bieber question was good. It was nice and funny, cleany weeny.
All right.
We can't end
next,
on that.
Next, well, we could. Next hand that shoots up is going to ask
next
the last question.
There question. It
is. Yes, sir. Margarita bath. I love the margarita bath with the hose on the show. It's so perfect.
Thank you. No, I haven't. Yes. I haven't.
And good night. Thank you all very much. It's the first of many chat shows that we will do based on your interest. Will Forte, Dana Carvey, Sam Levine, in the hiding, Jamie Foxx. We all thank you very much. Keep supporting live theater here at the Largo with the Cornet. Thank you, Flanagan and Michael. Thank you.